commissioned into infantry battalion of the Indian Army. That is 1st Guard, 2nd Punjab. To rub shoulders with the foreign armies and to stand tall as an Indian Army officer was a high point. I did some small team operations, very daring operations, put my life at stake for the nation and just didn't even bother even once ki kal kya hoga. Just don't carry your rank on the shoulders, but carry in the hearts of the people. It's not tough, but it's not easy either. Remain physically fit, remain mentally alert, and remain totally centrist. A passion in the heart and fire in the belly.
Myself, Gaurav Garg, and we welcome all our viewers to our show, Amazing Mentor. Today with us is Major General Dr. Yash Maur. He is experienced Major General with demonstrative history of working in government administration, a strong military and protective service professional, skill in crisis management, operation management, government emergency management and intelligence, associated in nature and wildlife conservation with Save the Himalaya Foundation and WWF. Major General Maur has experience of fighting terrorism in Punjab and Jammu and Kashmir and was awarded the Sena Medal and an Army Chief Commendation Card for gallantry during counter-terrorist operation in South Kashmir. It's a pleasure to welcome Major General Dr. Yash Maur to our show. Welcome, sir.
It's such a pleasure talking to you this morning.
Thank you. Same here, sir.
Yeah, I come from a Gulja's family based in rural Haryana. Basically, Hisar district, my village is Bas. It's a biggish village. So I was born in the village. My father was a soldier in the army. And I'm the first commissioned officer from my family, from that background, rural, rustic backdrop. But we are basically soldier farmers. But very early in my life, my father had this dream. His son should be an officer in the army. So he worked towards that. And from very beginning, he motivated me, inspired me, put me on the right track so that I, you know, clear all the hurdles and one day get a commission in the Indian Army. So childhood was, initial years was in the village, going after the buffaloes and going to the fields, normal kind of fun childhood, much before schooling started. Then, of course, once I went to school, then things changed. Started my schooling from a small kindergarten school in NDA, Khadgwasla, where my father was a weapons instructor. And then went on to in Dehradun. I did few classes. But the major change came when I, in fifth standard, I cleared the entrance exam to join as a cadet in Rashtriya Military School. That was in 1972. I joined Rashtriya Military School, Bangalore. That's a boarding school for wards of JCOs and OR and officers of the Indian Army.
So as a soldier son, what all hobbies you enjoyed as a child?
See, as a child, this part of being a soldier son didn't stick too much. As a child, you're a child, you know, whatever may be your background. So in school, I was totally into sports, fun-loving, always outside, never inside the class. And I was mostly in the library. These two things actually defined my life, the sports field and the library. I was not very good in studies. I was a backbencher throughout. I had no interest in text. I went to reading a lot. I continued to play a lot of games. I did a lot of boxing, athletics, cricket, football, hockey. You name a game and it was there. One more thing, one hobby I could cultivate in school was I became a debater early. So right in the first standard, I got a chance to debate in an inter-house debate competition. And that continued throughout my schooling and college. I enjoyed debates right up to my university level. So education, sports, and extracurricular activities that defined my childhood.
So generally, front bencher doesn't have stories or memories of their childhood, but the back bencher always has some naughty memories. So any naughty memories you would like to share with us?
As far as naughty memories are concerned, I have a lot of memories from my school time. Bunking classes, breaking bounds to go and see movies, sometimes making a chess match or a hockey match. In fact, I remember 1978, after a long time, the Pakistan team came and played a match in India. And the first test match was in Bangalore. And Asif Iqbal was the captain of the Pakistan team. And we have Bishan Singh Bedi here. And me and my friend, we bunked school. We stood in line whole night to buy a ticket to watch the match. 5-day match. We could buy the cheapest possible ticket. And after the ticket, we had a toss-up. Who would see the first day and who would see the second day? So I won the toss. So again, I had to bunk the whole day of school. Went very early, took this risk and saw the entire first day's match. I remember this vividly, and many such things we did to go and watch a match or a movie. Breaking bounds was part of our risk-taking abilities at that age.
So how was your journey to become an officer?
it was a quite incredible journey because by the time I reached my 11th or 12th, this idea started creeping in ki yes, I need to be an officer in the army. Or if I can wait a little longer and study harder or maybe prepare, go and become an IPS officer. Because my general knowledge was very good. I was into reading 2 to 3 newspapers. I knew everything about current affairs and anything beyond books. So that actually shaped my personality a lot. So I went to college and there again, I was into debating and dramatics and played for my college in handball, university level handball. Handball had just been introduced. And there I got this thing that first chance, I have to clear everything. And everything just happened. First chance, written exam, first chance, SSB, and went into the academy at the first possible opportunity. So it happened because I was so passionate, so motivated. In fact, there were 3-4 other friends of mine. I was able to mentor them at that age. They also cleared with me, or maybe a little later, but they also became officers with me.
So apart from the motivation from your father to become an officer, was there any other motivation to become an army officer?
Yeah, there was a huge motivation. Being a son of a soldier, you've seen officers, you always admire officers. So in his unit, in his environment around him, I used to see a lot of young officers. And I always thought, ki yaar yahan pahunchna hai kisi tarike se. And then school also, we had our administrative officer used to be a young captain, Captain Rajpal. I think he was a very inspiring figure, very dashing, very handsome. And he was a great motivator. So I think there were people who motivated and inspired me to be an officer.
So how was that heart-touching moment when you told your parents, okay, now I have become an officer?
Yeah, this is very interesting. You know, I went for my SSB to Bhopal, cleared my SSB. And those days, this message to a parents that you have successfully qualified. So after 4-5 days of SSB and 3-4 days of the medical, I caught a train from Bhopal to Delhi and then caught a bus to Jeen. That time we were in Jeen. My father was still in service. He was in Nagaland. So no way I could tell him. So around 10:30, 11 in the morning, I reached home and I kept my little bag there. And my mom was, doing this household chores in the morning. And she saw me and I stood in attention and saluted her. Oh, that moment, one of the prize moments of my life. She came running, hugged me. That was amazing, amazing moment. That was her dream come true. More than me, it was my parents' dream come true. So they were very, very thrilled. It was the big news.
Very heart-touching moment. So where did you start your career from?
See, I got commissioned into one of the finest and the oldest infantry battalion of the Indian Army, that is 1st Guard, 2nd Punjab. It was raised in 1762. In fact, the history of modern Indian Army is history of my unit. One of the most glorious units of the Indian Army. So I got commissioned as an infantry officer and we had some great stalwarts in the unit, some fine officers and great traditions in this unit. So initial years, I found it a little tough coping up with seniors who were very good. Then I found some amazing mentors there, people who guided me, who corrected me at the right time.
So how was your early days as an officer?
See, Gaurav, I got commissioned in 1985 from Indian Military Academy, Dehradun. And my first posting was in Meerut. It was a peace station, so there are a lot of sports. And my troops and my unit loved sports. So very quickly, within 6 months, I became darling of the troops and senior officers. And I was leading a couple of teams and rubbing shoulders with the troop. There's no difference when I was in the field, whether it's an officer or a jawan. So that was an amazing time. And during this time, we also took part in Exercise Brass Tacks and had a great privilege of meeting General Sundarji, one of the most illustrious generals ever produced by Indian Army. And then we went to Poonch in the Rajouri sector, where we saw a lot of firing, a lot of shelling and intense operations. And that is where I saw the genesis of the J&K insurgency start, sometimes in 87, 88. This was festering and a young mind could make out that something is amiss and something is going to happen. So those were very, very challenging years. Then we went to Poonch, that is on the line of control in the Rajouri sector, an area where every day there was firing, there was intense shelling. And the genesis of the J&K insurgency started right in front of my eyes. So those were tough days, but also good days. Learned a lot, played a lot. A lot of action one was able to see in first 3-4 years of initial life.
So what all departments have you handled in your course of journey?
Aside from the unit, I had the privilege of clearing the Defence Services Staff College in my first attempt and getting an instructor grading on the course. It was very, very prestigious, very tough. I went on a United Nations mission as a captain in 1993. I went to United Nations mission in Mozambique, in Southern Africa. That was amazing. Because we were just 8 captains selected out of the entire Indian Army. we went through a proper interview process. And going abroad, going to Mozambique, South Africa, I traveled extensively to Europe. At that age, that was an amazing exposure. And to rub shoulders with the foreign armies and to stand tall as an Indian Army officer was a high point. Handling issues of demobilization, handling local people, handling other countries. It was very, very thrilling experience to be part of the United Nations at that time.
So any particular moment you would like to share in your journey as an officer, best and the worst moment?
Some of the greatest moments came in my life in the insurgency in Punjab, where I was a company commander for the first time. This is the Patti Harike Tarantaran belt. And we did fabulously well. My company, I called them the cheetahs, you know, the cheetahs. We were able to eliminate many hardcore top militants in that time. But beyond this, bigger thing came when I went to Rashtra Rifles as a company commander in South Kashmir, where I got both my awards. But that is very minor. That actually transformed my life for later years, where, you know, I did some small team operations, very daring operations, put my life at stake for the nation, and just didn't even bother even once ki kal kya hoga. And I was not only able to motivate this 10 to 12 boys into eliminating the entire breed of Lashkar-e-Toyba, Harkat-ul-Jihad-e-Islami, Hizbul Mujahideen. Oh, we just went after them. But more than that, Gaurav, was that I learned the Quran. I made friends with people. I endeared myself to the local people. I had so much of love, affection, regard from the local people that genuinely won hearts and minds of the people. In fact, a lot of things now which will come out in my book and other things are related to this 2 years in South Kashmir, where you win hearts and minds of people. At the same time, you also eliminate anybody who dare bring an AK-47 into India illegally. So that was, I think, a very, very major moment for me as an officer of the Indian Army.
So any regret moment, any worst moment?
There was a fidayin, a suicide attack on the neighboring company. And we were the first responders. And I went there and saw ugly face of terrorism, where two hardcore militants entered our camp and they eliminated some 6-7 really fantastic boys. That was heart-wrenching, very sad moment for me to see that sometimes they can also get an upper hand. But that was a low point. Felt very sad about it, but sure that such things are not repeated. Otherwise, I think there have been moments you do feel low, but I've always had something to motivate myself from inside. It's not that it's been a roller coaster ride. There are low moments also in life. In army is quite a challenging career.
So you transformed Mr. Ata Mohammed Lathar from being a Pakistani trained militant to a soldier of Indian Army. How did you succeed in transforming a militant to a soldier first? And what was that one thing which made you confident that the militant can be our asset?
See, Gaurav, I told you, I picked up the Quran. I read the history of Kashmir. I read everything about the Prophet. And being an atheist, I just can't hate anyone. I know this love and affection for other communities, somewhere it has come naturally to me over the years. So this was a boy, we captured him alive from a village very close to my post. He came back broken mentally and physically. I started talking to him about his parents, his mother, his father, his family, and realized he's an educated, good boy. And we took care of him. It took 2-3 months for him to get all right, for us to build confidence. And then I started taking him for some of my operations. A stage came where I used to talk to him for hours together. And then I handed over my weapon to him. And that was a transformation. How many more people would have got inspired from Ata Mohammed's life? A lot of people told me, don't do this. You can't trust. I said, dekhi jayegi. Ye ek fitur hota hai. Ye is type ka kaam jo na asaan nahi hai. But I said, koi baat nahi. And I'm still in touch with him. He got married later on. His parents came and met. Every Diwali and Eid, we touch base. He's a proud soldier of Indian Army.
That's very nice, sir. So what are the areas you want to improve upon?
I have to improve upon so many aspects. I have to get digitally more aware and go along with the technology. Sometimes I feel technology is overtaking people like me. So I try my best to remain in touch with technology. And also, I think I trust people too much. I'm still very naive, take everybody at face value. I trust everybody too much. And then I feel sometimes people do backstab you. It happens. And now that I'm in the CV streets, I think I have to be, I don't know whether I can change myself, but I have this habit of immediately trusting people on the face value, you know, straight away.
What are your strengths?
My strength is my motivation level, my strong pluralism, strong ethos of my idea of India. Someday we will speak on this subject, my idea of India. So I have very, very strong feelings for my country, the future of my country, the future of youth. In fact, my objective in life is to inspire future leadership, to mentor future leaders of our country. So I think that is my strength, my being pluralistic, secular, believing in the idea of our country.
So what all mission have you handled?
I've handled right from company commander in Punjab, company commander in Kashmir, then brigade major of Armored Brigade, command of a unit, then command of a brigade. I commanded a tank brigade, an armored brigade on the Western Front. Then I was in the strategic planning group, writing future strategies and future doctrines. And then, of course, I've been into administrative jobs also. And then teaching. I was teaching in the Defense Services Staff College in Wellington. I also had an opportunity to do another staff college in Dhaka, Bangladesh, where I was pitted against the Pakistani and the Chinese officers. In fact, there is a wonderful account of one of the anecdotes of my tenure in Dhaka. If you Google search it, 2 mile run in Dhaka. It's immensely popular in India, Pakistan, all over. Millions of people have read that. So these are some of the very challenging missions and assignments. And of course, finally, it was in Ladakh. Again, I went back to Ladakh as GOC of the sub-area there.
So as an officer, what all challenges you feel are with the officer when compared to civilians?
Army life is quite different from being in the civil life. Here you are dealing with lives of people. So many people depend on you for not only guidance and motivation, for leadership. And in operations, you're the one who's taking a decision. So your decision, right or wrong, based on gut feeling or deep analysis, one doesn't know, but you are there. So it's a huge challenge. And then to be able to carry this day in and day out, not once. And then you have to walk the talk in the military. And just don't carry your rank on the shoulders, but carry in the hearts of the people. They should admire you for what you are. The kind of integrity, honesty, professionalism, truthfulness, passionate things that you bring on the table, and they see you. So as you go up, you're like a fish in the glass bowl, you know. 360 degree appraisal people have of you. So that is a challenge which is not there in the corporate cabins.
So as a CEO of Save the Himalaya Foundation Ladakh, what are the mission and vision of the organization?
See, Gaurav, after retirement, I've taken on this assignment of being the first CEO of the Save the Himalayas Foundation. It is a new foundation founded by Bhikkhu Sangh Senaji. He's a very renowned and highly respected monk in Ladakh. So this foundation, it is basically to save the ecology, fragile ecology of the Himalayas. It is to harness solar power for Himalayas. It is to encourage ecotourism, so that people do responsible tourism in these areas and also educate people. See, Himalayas transcends 8 countries and all our lives depend on Himalayas, and we have only one Himalaya. So everybody's life depends on that. If Himalayas die, we all die. So it's very, very important for us and everyone in South Asia, not only India, to take care of the Himalayas. So that is what is the aim and mission of this organization. This is my contribution to the society, this particular work.
So how was your 37 plus years journey as an officer?
I look back and it was just gone in a second. It was too fast paced, very, very passionate, and just events kept happening. I never planned. In fact, when I joined, you know, I was just thrilled by becoming an officer. From a soldier's son to an officer in the army was a big leap. And I never knew and I never planned. So things just kept happening. People, I kept meeting some amazing people who guided me, motivated me, inspired me. A lot of men inspired me. They always said, "Nahi, sir, you will go much higher." In fact, in their eyes, I should have been, you know, still serving in the army. It's fabulous.
So who is your mentor as an officer?
I have had many mentors, you know. When I was a young lieutenant, there was an officer retired as a brigadier, Brigadier P.S. Mann. I still treat him as my guru and meet him very often. I thought he transformed my life. He was a major when I joined, and he guided. He also came from very rustic, rural background from Patiala, and a gallantry winner of 1971 war, wounded in war in 1971. Very, very passionate man. Then later on, for my PhD, I had my guide, who's my friend philosopher now. And then, of course, I kept copying and seeing good ideas from a lot of people. I never hesitated to borrow an idea or a style of functioning from anyone.
So any moment in your career journey which made you think to quit as an officer?
I think this happened only once. I toiled with this idea for some time, 5-6 months. It was in 2007, after command of my unit, because education of my children was taking the priority. And there was pressure from home that you must quit and get into civil life. Many of my seniors, my, you know, mentors, they said, no. Even my men, nay, you can't quit. We want to see you rise to be a general in the army. So I toyed with that idea for about 5-7 months. That's about all. Otherwise, this never came because I was always very, very passionate. It was an incredible kind of profession and a journey.
So any rescue operation carried out for to save civilians?
In Kashmir or in Punjab or now in Ladakh, I have an amazing respect for citizens of our country, whatever class, creed, religion they belong to. So whenever there's a chance to help people, we did few rescue operations in Ladakh where people got stuck up on the passes, some college groups getting stuck up, some tourists getting stuck up. And then I've also had occasions where people need your care in far-flung areas. So whenever I went for trekking or things like that, I always carried a medical small team with me. And especially taking care of the old people, I conducted some very nice heart-touching eye camps for old people in Ladakh. And to get their blessings was amazing. And then, of course, taking care of people in far-flung areas is the only the army which can reach there. So even in Kashmir, many times when the snow falls, there's no light, rescuing people, injured people or pregnant women, these are part of our social responsibility. And whenever I got a chance, I did it with a lot of pride and happiness.
So any wildlife initiative or nature conservation project you did in Ladakh?
I've been associated with WWF very closely. We launched 3 campaigns. One was to save the brown bear, one of the most beautiful animals. Brown bear in India are only found in the Dras and Kargil area. And once we saw a video where people were stoning a small child bear, you know, brown bear, and fell into a river and died. So we launched a massive campaign to educate people, the schools, colleges on this particular aspect. Then is the, you know, snow leopard. It's a beautiful, very, very graceful animal found in the higher reaches of Ladakh. So we launched a campaign to save the snow leopard. And then we have the black neck crane, which is the bird of Jammu and Kashmir. And now, of course, the Ladakh Union Territory. It is found in the area of Chushul, where this fighting is taking place. It's a very, very special bird. So these 3 were our major campaigns.
So any decision or action you regret in your career?
I don't have any such regrets. But yes, I may have been liberal with some people at some time. But otherwise, I've loved people from bottom of my heart. So with Jawans, with my subordinates, I've never felt any kind of negative vibes. By and large, no regrets at all, Gaurav.
So what are your future plans and what's your success mantra?
See, my future plans have become more busy now after superannuation. So I have a couple of books on hand, which have to come out in a year or two. Then I want to write maybe script a Netflix or Amazon Prime series on my life in Kashmir.
So how to join Indian Armed Forces and what are the different options if anybody want to join Armed Forces?
The Armed Forces is an amazing career. Army, Navy, Air Force, and people who want to join must start early. You know, shape your personality to join the Armed Forces. So becoming physically fit, becoming aware of your surroundings, and also cultivating the secular breed and fabric in you, not the hate and bigotry we see in civil street these days. And of course, polishing your communication skills, that is very important. And there are many options, right from NDA to IMA to short service, technical entry, and engineering entry. You can get through medical, you can do an MBBS, or you can do MBBS with us and then join, or do MBBS and PG and come and join us. And there are many other specialized professions in Air Force and Navy also. You can come into Education Corps. You can come as a lawyer. We need lawyers also in the Army. So there are many options for people who want to join, and it's a wonderful career, but start early.
So what advice would you like to give to new officers?
See, to the new officers, my advice is remain fit. Remain physically at the top of your fitness. We need a fit army. You don't know when the opportunity will come. Kab mauka lagega, aapko pata nahi chalega. You see what is happening in Eastern Ladakh, what happened in Kargil or Siachen or Sri Lanka. Nobody thought it's going to happen. So remain physically fit, remain mentally alert, and remain totally centrist. There's too much of propaganda that goes on in the social media space. Stay away from it. Remain focused towards the true ethos and ethics and morals of this great army.
So what all are do's and don't you suggest while preparing for Armed Forces?
The do's are be aware of your current affairs, what is happening around you, polish your communication skills, remain physically fit, remain motivated, and you have to find your own path. Nobody else can do it for you. And don'ts are exactly opposite. You can't be unfit and then want to join the army. Have good habits. So you have to imbibe, even if your family is not like this, just jettison this baggage.
So your advice to young generation on why they should join Armed Forces?
Don't join it as a career. Join it that, yeah, I want to be an officer, wear this uniform of Army, Navy or Air Force. So this has to come from within and start preparing early. And if you have the passion, even if you can't get through, you will finally reach. That I've seen so many people. They will finally become an officer. It's not tough, but it's not easy either. So you have to prepare yourself.
So now we will start our rapid round. Favorite actor and actress?
I think I'll go for Nasiruddin Shah and Smita Patel, Shabana Azmi.
Favorite color?
Favorite color is blue. Sky is the blue.
Favorite destination?
My favorite destination is Cape Town, is Paris, is Ladakh.
Favorite car?
I love this Innova, Toyota Innova. That's my car at the moment. I love it.
Things in your wish list?
Is to write books, produce a series on the OTT platforms, Netflix, Amazon Prime, if possible. Do some acting assignment if it comes my way. And very soon, I would like to be on TEDx or Josh Talks.
One thing that you would like to change if you are provided superpowers?
See, I don't know whether becoming a superpower will solve any problem. But if I have one power granted to me in our country, I will stop religious propaganda, religious hatred. This is one thing I would like to change.
Second choice of career?
My second choice of career would be maybe a writer. I would love to be an author and maybe a professor. I would like to teach also.
Dream house?
Dream house, I'm not too attached to house. I'm a mentally mobile person, so I can live anywhere in the country or abroad.
At last, one thing that defines you?
A passion in the heart and fire in the belly.
So thank you very much, sir, for sharing your life experience with us. It's a pleasure talking to you, sir.
No, I enjoyed this interaction.